We got type patterns, guarded patterns, record patterns. 16,777,217. Nested patterns, pattern matching to Java.
The reason for Java.
16,777,216. Unnamed patterns to the rescue.
Big decimal.
This is called a primitive pattern, and Java 23 will allow exactly that. Constant patterns.
Big decimal. Big decimal.
216. Instance patterns. Primitive patterns. Deconstruction patterns. Static patterns. Welcome everyone to the Inside Java Newscast, where we cover recent developments in the OpenJDK community. I'm Nikolai Parlock, Java developer advocate at Oracle, and today we're going to talk about primitive patterns in Java 23, primarily. But we'll also put them in context of the patterns we already got and the ones we'll probably get in the future, because the partial introduction of patterns into Java has unbalanced it, and we'll see how future additions will once again bring balance to the force, the language. Ready? Then let's dive right in. The introduction of pattern matching to Java is a great example of incremental development. This is a big feature with wide-ranging implications for how we write code, but we see it appear piece by piece. First, we got type patterns, which allow us to take a variable and check whether it's of a specific reference, and if it is, create a new variable of that type with the given name. Check, declaration, and assignment or extraction, that's the triad of pattern matching. We got type patterns in instanceof, and a few releases later, also in switch. The introduction of patterns to switch also brought guarded patterns, which specialize a pattern in a case with additional Boolean checks. That allows us to express those conditions on the left side of the arrow, which is great, because then all selection criteria can go there, while the right side is exclusively concerned with processing the selected variables. Pushing expressive and succinct selection further are record patterns. Since a record's state is transparent, Java doesn't only know how to put a record together and can thus generate a constructor, it also knows how to take it apart, and record patterns allow just that. But always listing all record components becomes cumbersome really quickly because you often only need a few of them. Unnamed patterns to the rescue. Simply replace the patterns for the record components you don't need with an underscore, and you not only ease writing and reading of the code, you also express unequivocally that you don't care about those variables. When you're putting an unnamed pattern into a record pattern, or a type or record pattern into another record pattern for that matter, you're nesting them. And while that's very natural to do, it's not like the compiler just starting allowing that. No, this feature is called nested patterns, and was introduced together with record patterns because so far they're the only ones where nesting makes sense. So, to summarize, we can match against reference types. We can deconstruct records in a way that mirrors their construction. We can nest patterns within one another where that makes sense. We can ignore parts of a pattern with unnamed patterns. We can do all that in instanceof and in switch. And in switches, we can further refine the selection with guarded patterns. That's all pretty good, and you might have heard me describe that, plus sealed types, as the pattern matching basics. But it's only really that, the basics. There are more features to be built on this, but importantly, this also needs to be built out, because what we have so far puts more weight on some parts of the language than on others. So let's turn to what these imbalances are and how Java 23 and beyond are going to address them. Historically, instanceof only work with reference types. Because there is no abstraction over primitives, that makes sense. No variable is potentially a byte. Either it is declared as one, then it is one, or it's of some other type, and then it cannot be a byte. With the introduction of pattern matching, instanceof changed its semantics though. It's no longer just, is this variable of that type? Now it means, does this variable match this pattern? Meaning, does it fulfill a certain condition? And asking this question can make sense for primitives. So when the old instanceof would have asked, is this variable a byte? The answer would have always been no. But now instanceof could ask, can this variable be represented as a byte? And the answer to that is yes for all variables that represent an integer between -128 and +127. This is called a primitive pattern, and Java 23 will allow exactly that. The check goes beyond ranges though. Here's a special number, 16,777,217. It's special because it's the smallest int that cannot be represented as a float. Specifically, creating it as a float will result in 16,777,216. So you could ask, is 16,000,216 an instance of float? Yes. But is 60,000,217 an instance of float? No. It's within the bounds of float, but it cannot be represented. And primitive patterns check this as well. This is much better than what we have now, where we'd have to cast and suddenly lose information. This fixes the imbalance of reference and primitive types in instance of that was created by the change in its semantics. But what about switch? You could argue that it was seriously lopsided even before patterns. The list of types to switch over was somewhat eclectic. Byte, short, int, char, wait, where's long, string, and all enums. Then recently we added all reference types to the list, but what about long and float and double while we're at it? This change fixes that as well. Now all primitives, including booleans, can be switched over. And since there are patterns for them, you can catch their value for additional guards on the left side of the arrow or for ease of use on the right. In accordance with the recent developments, switching over one of the newly allowed primitive types or using a pattern in a switch over one of the old types turns the switch into one that insists on exhaustiveness. That means your switch statement over int doesn't have to cover all cases, but once you turn it into an expression, or switch over long, or add a pattern, then it does. That's annoyingly imbalanced on its own, but I don't see a fix for that that doesn't break all old switches, so it looks like we have to live with it. There's one more place where primitive patterns improve balance, and that's in nested patterns. If you deconstruct a record, you don't have to match the component types exactly. Quite the opposite. You can use subtypes of the component types to only select those record instances that hold an instance of that subtype. That used to not apply to primitive components, you had to match those exactly. With the semantics of primitive patterns, that'll be a thing of the past. You can now select those record instances whose component fits, for example, into a byte, regardless of whether it is declared as a byte or any other primitive numerical type. As usual, there's a bit more to the topic that I'm covering here. For example, a table explaining which primitive conversions are unconditionally exact and which are widening and which are narrowing. For all that, check out JDK Enhanced Proposal 455. It proposes to preview primitive patterns in JDK 23 and is already integrated. So you can download a 23 early access build right now and start playing with them. So primitive patterns fix an imbalance in how patterns, primitives, instance of and switch work. But this doesn't fix all such issues, and it turns out that all four upcoming patterns I found in the Amber design documents, link below the like button, can be viewed through the lens of returning balance. Hey, editor Nicola here. I forgot to mention, all upcoming features and their syntax are of course hypothetical. No promises. For example, we've just talked about how record patterns are the inverse of a record constructor. But where's the inverse of a regular class's constructor? Don't get me wrong, most classes don't lend themselves to this kind of deconstruction, but some do. What about them? Deconstruction patterns are the answer. With them, you can manually define a deconstruction contract analogous... A deconstruction contract analogous... A deconstruction contract analogous to defining a construction contract with a constructor. Record patterns are then just a special, automatically generated case of deconstruction patterns. So we generalize the conceptual pair constructor record pattern for records to constructor deconstruction pattern for all classes. But some classes prefer not to expose their constructor and have clients go through static factory methods instead. Optional is a good example with off and empty. To mirror that in deconstruction, we may get static patterns. So you could ask, to continue the example, whether an optional was created off string s and the pattern matches if the optional contains a string. Whereas static patterns ask whether a variable fulfills a general, static if you wish, condition, instance patterns go a step further and ask whether a variable fulfills condition based on some other variable's state. This will be big. Everyday programming contains uncounted statements that implement if this fulfills that, extract those variables. For example, if this string matches that regex pattern, extract the groups. If this key is contained in that map, extract the value, etc., etc. Instance patterns allow expressing these checks, declarations, and extractions in one concept, making them all more succinct, safer, and potentially atomic, thus considerably improving Java code. For the last pattern I found in the documents, assume you switch over a point with x, y coordinates, and one branch needs the y coordinate, but should only be taken if x is 0. Of course, you could extract x and y and use a guarded pattern to check whether x is 0. But this is less expressive than it could be. Deconstruction is supposed to mirror construction, and there you just call new point 0, y. Constant patterns fix this imbalance and allow matching a value to a constant. Somewhat pointless in and of itself, they work great when nested in other patterns. The example I just gave would be simplified to case point 0, var y. Neat. Why not download a 23EA build, link in the description, and give primitive patterns a spin? Using preview features and source file execution has become even easier in 23 because you only need Java enable preview and can ally it source number. So it's a text file, a main method, and that simple command to start experimenting that has never been easier. And that's it for today on the Inside Java Newscast. I hope you had a good time. If so, you can do me a favor and let YouTube know with a like. And if you're not subscribed, why? Do it now, and I'll see you again in 2 weeks. So long!